Recorded Books presents A History of the Church Through Its Buildings by Allan Doig. Narrated by John Curless. Introduction. Buildings are about people. The people who conceive, design, finance, and use them. Their stories become embedded in the very fabric itself, the bricks and mortar, and, as the fabric is changed through time in response to changing use, relationships, and beliefs, the architecture becomes the standing history of the passing waves of humanity. This process takes on particular significance in churches as places of worship and ceremony. The arrangement of the spaces places members of the community in relationship with one another for the performance of the rites and ceremonies of the church. Moreover, architectural forms and building materials can be used to establish relationships with other buildings in other places and other times. Coordinated systems of signs, symbols, and images conjure beliefs, doctrine, and even extended narratives of the people and their faith. As an example, the mosaic over the door to the entrance or narthex of the great church of Hagia Sophia in Istanbul, Constantinople, shows Emperor Constantine the Great to the right holding a model of the walls of Constantinople, which he founded as New Rome, the capital of a reunified empire. And to the left is Emperor Justinian I, holding a model of Hagia Sophia itself, which he built on the ruins of the original built by Constantine. Together, they offer these to the Virgin and Child, dedicating the church, the city, the empire, and the people to them. Constantine had changed the course of history by his conversion, but what was the nature of his conversion? Was it the divine revelation he is said to have had in 312 at the Milvian Bridge before his victory over the tyrant Maxentius? Or was it a revelation of an altogether pragmatic kind of political as much as religious power? Whichever was the case, his friend and advisor, Bishop Eusebius, delivered him both through his development of a narrative theology of empire as a reflection of Christ's rule in the kingdom of heaven. The pre-Constantinian church met in existing buildings, mostly houses, borrowed for communal worship. Only when these buildings began to be altered for their changed use in ways that can be conclusively archaeologically identified, is it possible to say that there is at least a proto-church building. The choice of building and the nature of the alterations that were found to be necessary together begin to flesh out the early story. Then, suddenly, with Constantine's vision and consequent victory over Maxentius, great basilicas begin to appear. The victorious emperor completed the Basilica of Maxentius and Constantine, then, in quick succession, built a magnificent new one for the Bishop of Rome at the Lateran, one for Peter, as Prince of the Apostles and founder of the Church in Rome, over what was believed to be his grave on the Vatican Hill, and one at the site revered as the place of the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre, in Chapter 1, in combination with other churches, shrines, and sites in the Holy Land, allows the pilgrim to relive biblical events and walk where Jesus himself walked. The death and resurrection of Jesus were key moments in the origins of the church and the wellspring of its theology. The Holy Cave, which was the tomb of Christ, was itself buried under tons of rubble and had a pagan temple built over it. There is archaeological evidence that pilgrimage to the site began very early, despite its Christian significance being totally obliterated by the Roman pagan temple. When the temple was removed and the site excavated by order of Constantine, the tomb took on the appearance of a representation of the Saviour's return to life. It became the testimony, or witness to the truth, of the good news of the resurrection from death to new life. Constantine stipulated that the church that replaced the temple should be worthy of the world's most miraculous place. When a basilica was built at the site, and as the pilgrimage grew, it would be a unifying touchstone for Christian belief, worship, and the celebration of the liturgy. Holy places aren't only places of unity and healing, they can also be sources of conflict, and the Holy Sepulchre has more than once occasioned the clash of empires. Christianity was taken to the heart of the Roman Empire by St. Peter and St. Paul, who both died for their faith during the persecution under Emperor Nero. Peter was crucified upside down on the spine of the circus across the river from the capital on the edge of the Vatican Hill. Soon after defeating Maxentius and taking Rome, Constantine built the Lateran Basilica, the Basilica Constantiniana, as a thank offering to Christ for his victory. The nature of the church was forever changed by the conversion of the emperor. In his project to consolidate and unify the empire, it's possible that Constantine thought that the church, unified around its bishops, should contribute to that unity. In any case, the unity of the Church around the Bishop of Rome as the successor of Peter, Prince of the Apostles, would be enhanced by building another vast basilica focused on the Apostles' grave on the Vatican Hill, despite the difficulty of the site. Claiming succession from Peter, the Bishop of Rome also claimed the same authority bestowed by Christ when he said, "You are Peter, and on this rock will I build my church." Matthew chapter 16, verse 18. Ever since that claim was made, St. Peter's Basilica, in chapter 2, has been the focus of Catholic unity and papal authority. Building Constantinople as the new Rome consolidated Constantine's power over both the Eastern and Western Empire, and he built a grand basilica there as well. Constantine's confidant and historian, Bishop Eusebius of Caesarea, developed a theology in which the empire was a direct reflection of the kingdom of heaven, and where the Church of Hagia Sophia, in chapter 3, the wisdom of God, in particular, was the bridge as heaven on earth. That theological conception was shattered early in 532, when the basilica, the baths, and part of the sacred palace were destroyed in the Nika riots, and Emperor Justinian was very nearly deposed. To recover from such a devastating attack on the religious, symbolic and ceremonial heart of the capital would require rebuilding on a scale, magnificence and speed that would astonish and make the destruction appear to have been God's providence. The result was everything Justinian could have hoped for, and in its materials, its coloured marbles from around the Mediterranean, the church gathered the geography of his empire symbolically into itself. In the fabric of this building, church and empire were perfectly fused. New Rome had interests through the Black Sea and beyond into Kievan Rus. His grand prince, Vladimir, converted in 986-7 along with his people, and he married the sister of the Byzantine emperor in 988. The new church in Rus came under the Patriarch in Constantinople, and of course it took the same model, including a formerly similar architecture with Kiev and its churches, including its Cathedral of the Holy Wisdom, modelled on Constantinople. Its lineal descendant, the Cathedral of the Domitian in Moscow's Kremlin, in Chapter 4, is the ultimate statement of the fusion of church and state within the Russian national identity, with two thrones facing the iconostasis, one for the patriarch and the other the monomach throne, which has carvings recording the gift of imperial honours from the Byzantine emperor to his grandson, Vladimir the Tsar. The whole of the interior is peopled with images of angels, archangels, saints, and emperors, including Constantine and his mother, Helena. With these imperial, ecclesiastical, and architectural connections, it wasn't difficult at the fall of Constantinople in 1453 for the Grand Dukes, with their power base now in Moscow, to reconceive their city as the Third Rome. The Russian Orthodox Church would be all but extinguished under Stalin's regime, but since Glasnost in the late 1980s, there has been a resurgence, with old churches rebuilt and new ones established, all on the traditional model reuniting church and state within a renewed Russian identity. In the 8th century, when the Pope was under threat from the Lombards and also from his own curia, he was unable to depend on support from the Eastern Emperor, so he appealed to Charlemagne, King of the Franks, the most powerful leader in the West. Charlemagne's favourite place was Aachen, where he built the Church of the Holy Mother of God, in Chapter 5. It was a mirror of the kingdom. Significant parts of the building were of marble removed from the last emperor's palace in Ravenna, or from Rome itself. His throne in the gallery was constructed of marble from the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. It was a reliquary throne that also contained relics of St. Stephen, proto-martyr, Acts chapter 6, verses 5 through 7, verse 60. The octagonal church was related in architectural form to San Vitale in Ravenna, built by Emperor Justinian, who is portrayed in its mosaics, and to the palace chapel of Saints Sergius and Bacchus, completed in 536 by Justinian in Constantinople. Charlemagne's church in Aachen was built between 794 and 799. In its form and symbolism, it was cultivating Romanitas, the quality of Romanness, and a Catholic realm in conformity with the church in Rome. Under him, both the monasteries and the liturgy were reformed. Through education offered by the church, that Roman practice was gradually spread throughout the kingdom into the parishes. Charlemagne was crowned emperor on Christmas Day 800 in St. Peter's Basilica, embodying his motto of Renovatio Romani Imperii. The Abbey of Saint-Denis, in Chapter 6, was a basilical monastery providing services for the pilgrimage to the grave of the first bishop of Paris, Saint-Denis, and his companions, Rusticus and Eleutherius, who were all martyred during the persecution under the Emperor Decius in the 3rd century. With a burgeoning pilgrimage and under royal patronage, the abbey thrived. Charlemagne rebuilt its west end over the grave of his father, Pepin, the beginning of the royal line. At Saint-Denis, Pope Stephen had anointed Pepin king along with his sons Carloman and Charles, later to be Charlemagne. Pepin then obligingly defeated the Lombards, who were threatening Rome. Abbot Suger, abbot of Saint-Denis, 1122 to 1151, put the abbey in good administrative and financial order after the rather loose hold of his predecessor, Abbot Adam, and reformed the abbey following the insistent promptings of Bernard of Clairvaux. Politically, Suger stiffened the resolve of King Louis XVI to support the church in the investiture controversy that split the church and the politics of Europe from the late 11th century to the early 12th centuries over the right of rulers to invest bishops with their insignia of office. Suger gave Louis the banner of the saint as a battle standard, and when the threatened attack by the English king and the emperor never came, Louis fulfilled his vow to support the rebuilding of the abbey. The East End was completed in 1144, the first fully integrated Gothic choir. Suger appealed to the theological writings of Dionysius, Denis, the Areopagite, whom he associated with Saint-Denis, despite the discrepancy in dates. When Louis went on the Second Crusade in 1145, preached by St. Bernard, Suger served as regent of France, helping to unite France and increased the power of the king. The glorious building served as a backdrop for royal ceremonial that enhanced the unity of the abbey, the church, and the king. In the middle of the 15th century in England, Alice Chaucer, Duchess of Suffolk and granddaughter of the poet Geoffrey, founded God's House, in Chapter 7, on the family estate in Ewelme in Oxfordshire. This foundation demonstrates how the church reached into every aspect of medieval life, from cradle to grave and beyond. There was a family chantry chapel in the rebuilt parish church, a cloister of almshouses attached to its west end just down the hill, and a parish school just below that to the west. The almsmen were to work for their keep by praying for Alice and her family. The living were to be employed by the dead to see them through purgatory to paradise. Her tomb and the tomb of her parents were both emblazoned with coats of arms, showing the family's connections with some of the grandest and most powerful names in the land. It wasn't simply name-dropping. It was a kind of display of where she fitted in the social order. Though the social structure seems clearly fixed by birth, it was in reality remarkably unstable, with politics and power ebbing and flowing, so the look of permanence was belied by political realities. Christian religious reality was perhaps predictable, but there was a great uncertainty about the tariff of prayer to see you through purgatory to salvation. That prayer could leave the departed in purgatory for a long time unless dedicated professionals were hired to organize and carry it out. The dual royal foundation of Eton College and King's College, Cambridge, began in a similar way to God's House at Ewelme, but soon was re-established for a grander, more outward-looking educational purpose. Alice was also a benefactress of that broader educational purpose in her support for the building of the new Divinity School at Oxford. Chantry, chapels, and their clergy were also contributed to the pastoral provision of the parishes, and the church was involved in educational reforms. But the vast wealth tied up by the dead in employing the living was too much of a temptation to modern monarchs who had diplomacy to conduct and wars to fight. After the conquest of Constantinople by the Ottoman Turks, Hagia Sophia, the Great Church, became the Great Mosque. After the Reconquista, the Great Mosque of Cordoba, in Chapter 8, became the Cathedral in 1235. That building had itself replaced the mid-6th century Cathedral of St. Vincent, a Christian church that for a time seems to have been shared between the Christian community and the Muslim conquerors. The new mosque, begun in 785-6, was a magnificent architectural conception, reusing forms, details, architectural elements and materials from what had gone before, and synthesizing it all into a fresh, new style. It was a vast open forest of columns, directional aisles only subtly differentiated. Without extensive architectural changes beyond the provision of chapels after the Reconquista, it's difficult to imagine how the major liturgies of the church would have been celebrated, but the building had to be retained and its worship replaced by Christian worship. In 1523, permission was given by Emperor Charles V to build a cathedral within the vast space. The result was the insertion of a late Gothic, early Renaissance cathedral, laterally disrupting the seemingly endless and numinous space. The conflict displayed within the architecture continues to be played out in conflict between the religious communities. Attacks on the authority of Rome and its bishop occurred in 410 with the sack of Rome by Alaric the Goth, in the 8th century with the Lombards threatening Rome, and in 1046 when Emperor Henry III charged Pope Gregory VI with corruption and deposed him. In 1076, Emperor Henry IV had Pope Gregory VII deposed over the investiture controversy. The Pope excommunicated Henry, who laid siege to Rome for 2 years. Rome fell, and the end result was an anti-pope and a pope. Pope Clement V, who was French, abandoned Rome for Avignon in 1305. And by the time Pope Martin V returned more than a century later, the fabric of old St. Peter's Basilica was found to be in such a poor state it had to be rebuilt. The papal basilica had to display the authority of St. Peter's successor and the majesty and unity of the church. Old St. Peter's showed the age and the cracks of a creaking institution. A false start was made by Nicholas V in the middle of the 15th century. Then, on the 18th of April, 1506, Pope Julius II laid the foundation stone for what would finally develop into the present building, with contributions by some of the greatest artists ever to have lived: Bramante, Raphael, San Gallo the Younger, Michelangelo, Maderno, Fontana, and Della Porta. The problem in building the new Renaissance St. Peter's Papal Basilica, in Chapter 9, was not artistic, but financial. A deal struck with a German archbishop drew the protest of Martin Luther in his 95 Theses in 1517, and the building that was to proclaim the majesty and unity of the church proved to be the spark in a lot of existing dry tinder to feed the flames of the Reformation. The painted ceiling in the church of Sant'Ignazio in Rome, in Chapter 10, is an apotheosis of St. Ignatius, founder of the Society of Jesus, the Jesuits, in 1540, and shows the evangelization of Europe, Africa, America, and Asia by the Society. The Jesuits established schools everywhere, and this church is the chapel of the Collegio Romano, then the central educational establishment of the Society. It is a gorgeous preaching box, with a very open east end, giving easy access to the sanctuary. Together, the church and its ceiling show the vigour of the Counter-Reformation or Catholic Reformation, riposte to Protestant fury. There is a brief biblical text from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verse 49, on the ceiling. "I came to cast fire upon the earth." It was the fire of evangelization and conversion. And the narrative of the ceiling tells its story from Europe all the way to China. Despite its themes of light and fire, the narrative of the ceiling also reveals the dark side of this imperial venture, with some of the figures wearing leg irons. Even within the triumphalist crescendo of an apotheosis, it's impossible to conceal the depth of human tragedy accompanying the advance of empire. The Pope censured the treatment of slaves, but was forced to soften his protest under imperial pressure. The Church's ministry to the victims was woeful, though more effective among indigenous populations in South America. The Jesuit way of proceeding involved inculturation, visible in the hybrid detail of their architecture. This was both quite novel and deeply offensive to many. In the Chinese context, the leaders of the Jesuit mission adopted the role of traditional Chinese scholars, translating both Western sciences and the Christian message into Chinese and embedding them into a familiar cultural medium. The scientific achievements of the Jesuit Matteo Ricci, in collaboration with the court official Xu Guangqi, are still celebrated in China. Dominican and Franciscan missionaries objected to the policy of inculturation, and the Jesuits were censured for their acceptance of Confucian ceremonial rites. In the 18th and 19th centuries, British missionary societies left an architectural record around the world. George Edmund Street was diocesan architect for the Diocese of Oxford from 1850, having worked as an assistant in George Gilbert Scott's office until just the year before. As diocesan architect, he restored a great number of its parish churches and built Cuddesdon Theological College near Oxford. In January 1857, he entered a competition to build the Crimean Memorial Church, in Chapter 11, in Istanbul. Though he was placed second to William Burgess in the competition, after many difficulties, Burgess was replaced by Street in 1863. Curiously, the Church of the Holy Sepulchre had been a proximal cause of the Crimean War, and in the wake of the war, the British were a very powerful presence in Istanbul, and their presence wasn't marked by the dignity of a place of worship, as for other foreign communities. Their presence was also marred by the behaviour of their sailors, who were constantly getting into trouble when at a loose end on Sundays. So three different interests came together to build the church. A national memorial was demanded by a people affected by war. The British ambassador to the Sublime Porte agreed an adequate British presence was needed as a projection of soft power, and the English chaplain and his associate at the British hospital near the port, Florence Nightingale, saw the acute pastoral need for a place of worship. The memorial church was indeed eventually completed, but not until 1876. The second half of the 19th century saw the British Empire reach its greatest geographical extent, and English parish churches were built by missionary societies around the globe. It was an uncomfortable relationship, with most churches built in a hostile climate, either literally in places like Canada, or frequently in relation to the local population, or indeed the colonial administration itself. The buildings themselves also have their stories to tell as standing history, when half the map of the world was pink, showing the British Empire. But communities and their pastoral needs change over time, a process that has left its mark on the fabric of the memorial church, as it has on these other far-flung exotic hybrids. In the 20th century, the world and the church were racked by war. Coventry and its cathedral, in Chapter 12, destroyed on the night of the 14th to the 15th of November 1940, became so emblematic of the destruction and loss of life that the German word Coventrieren was coined. St. Paul's Cathedral became the symbol of the survival of London, and the new cathedral at Coventry was to be the British Phoenix, rising from the flames. Both church and nation were looking to this phoenix, but the renewed form of the one may not be the same as the renewed form of the other. Did the church in particular have a clear vision for the future, or was it a phoenix too soon? In this history of the church in 12 buildings, The aim has been to provide tangible connection to the lives of the people involved in some of the key moments and movements that shaped that history. Standing in the same place where they preached and taught, or in a space they built as a memorial, touching the stone they placed or that marks their final resting place, comes close to shared experience. It is the existential connection, the personal touch of a keepsake or a relic. These are some of the places where the faces of the past may come more clearly into focus. Chapter 1. The World's Most Miraculous Place. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre. There is no better place to begin a history of the Church than at a site that many Christians believe to be the very place where key events of the biblical narrative actually took place. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem is, according to Christian tradition, where Jesus was crucified, buried, and, crucially, rose again to new life. Relevant passages from the Jewish historian Josephus, from Bishop Eusebius, contemporary and biographer of Constantine, the pilgrim of Bordeaux, and the pilgrim Egeria, late 4th century, give a flavor of how contemporary Christians interpreted the sites of Jerusalem and its surroundings. The site of the Holy Sepulchre is as contentious as the events and their interpretation, as the long sequence of building, destruction, and rebuilding shows. The first building on the site, obliterating what may already have been a place of Christian pilgrimage, was a pagan temple to Capitoline Jupiter, built in the mid-2nd century by Emperor Hadrian. That temple was finally removed, beginning in 326 CE under Emperor Constantine the Great, and by 335, a great Christian basilica was ready to be consecrated. Only a few vestiges of that building survive. It was in its turn burnt by the Persians in 614, but soon rebuilt. When Omar wrested the territory from the Byzantines in 638, the basilica survived, but in 1009, its destruction was ordered by Caliph Hakim. In 1114, rebuilding began by the victorious Crusaders, who by the 1160s had completed the Romanesque church that now stands where the original courtyard of the Constantinian basilica used to be. The fabric of this ancient church is palimpsest, with layers telling the stories of different periods in the church's history. But then, almost all ancient church buildings do that. The approach. The approach to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre reveals a surprisingly modest architectural arrangement. Coming down the long steps from the west, or up through the narrow gate from the souk that had been the old Roman cardo, brings you to a low platform above a small paved square opposite a narrow, double-bayed church facade, an unlikely entrance to the holiest site in the Christian world. This wasn't always so, and there are still aspects of the present structure that are impressive, even extravagant. This place and all that happened here have been the triggers for events of wider, truly global significance. It has been the object of almost 2 millennia of pilgrimage. It was key in Constantine's creation of a Christian empire. The recapture of this sacred site was the objective of the First Crusade and became the heart of the Crusader kingdom. It lit the fuse for the Crimean War. There's been such a flashpoint for war that the status quo governing its daily life was enshrined in international law by the Treaty of Berlin in 1878. But many have questioned whether this precise spot in the middle of the old city of Jerusalem could really have been the scene of the crucifixion and burial of Jesus, and there have been competing locations such as the Garden Tomb or Gordon's Tomb. Archaeological opinions vary, but there is broad agreement that the events of the Passion brought Jesus to this place of execution and to this sepulchre. The rock of Golgotha, the place of the skull, is folded into the chapels immediately on the right of the entrance to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, and the sepulchre itself is entirely clad in the marble of what is known as edicule, under the dome at the focus of the whole architectural complex. According to Christian tradition, this is the location of what are considered to be the foundational events of the Christian religion, the Passion, Crucifixion, Entombment, and Resurrection of Jesus. The belief that all this happened here is the reason why this site has for so long been the focus of Christian pilgrimage. The biblical narratives describing the events of the last week of Jesus' life and the associated places have created a sacred geography mapped onto the topography of Jerusalem. For almost 2 millennia, pilgrims have come to ponder the events of the last week of Jesus' life in real places, bound as a holy geography centered around the sepulchre. It has always mattered that this be the very place and the way it relates to other holy sites, Christian, Jewish, and Muslim, was crucial to the way its history unfolded. It's worth following the biblical narrative past the sites leading to the palace that Emperor Constantine called the world's most miraculous place. Jesus' final journey. The year of Jesus' fateful arrival in Jerusalem for the Passover is thought to have been 30 CE. The biblical account recounts that he arrived not just with the 12, but with the whole multitude of the disciples. What brought Jesus from this triumphant entry into Jerusalem when he was hailed as the King that cometh in the name of the Lord to Calvary, Golgotha, the place of a skull, and that most painful and ignominious of deaths by crucifixion? The Gospels relate that during this triumphal entry, Jesus looked across the valley of the Kidron to the magnificent city, wept over it, and prophesied the destruction of both the city and its temple. The city at that date was the impressive result of rebuilding by the Hasmonean dynasty in the late 2nd century BCE. And from the time of his crowning as King of the Jews in 37 BCE, Herod the Great had added huge building projects, including the Bethesda Pool, the Siloam Pool, the Second Wall, a marvelously engineered aqueduct, a lavish palace, and above all, the recently finished magnificent new temple on a much extended platform. According to the Gospel of Luke, coming down the Mount of Olives to the east of the city, borne along by the crowd, Jesus prophesied, "For the day shall come upon thee when thine enemies shall cast up a bank about thee, and compass thee around, and keep thee in on every side, and shall dash thee to the ground, and thy children within thee. And they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another, because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation." Luke chapter 19, verses 41 to 44. In 70 CE, the temple was destroyed. And in this passage, Luke is providing his theological reflection on the devastating event. Herod the Great died in 4 BCE, and when Jesus is said to have lamented over Jerusalem, it was Herod Antipas, his son, who ruled as tetrarch of Galilee. Jesus called him that fox. But Jerusalem had clearly prospered under Rome, and the leaders of Jewish society had every reason to want to fall in with Roman authority. The Jewish historian Flavius Josephus, writing in the years following the fall of Jerusalem, and destruction of the temple adds another perspective in the Jewish war. In what may be a later Christian interpolation, the text says of Jesus that there assembled unto him of ministers 150 and a multitude of the people. Now when they saw his power, that he accomplished whatsoever he would by word, and when they had made known to him their will, that he should enter into the city and cut down the Roman troops and Pilate and rule over us, he disdained us not, or heeded us not. Quite apart from the commotion caused by this jubilant crowd at Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, the day can't have been comfortable for those in authority, either in the temple or among the Roman garrison. Great festivals like the approaching Jewish Passover, which brought upwards of 200,000 worshippers and their animals for sacrifice into Jerusalem, also brought a worrying potential for disorder. The narrative does indeed describe a fracas in the temple precincts, with Jesus overturning the tables of the irate money changers, spilling money everywhere, causing chaos, and disrupting the legitimate functioning of the place. The Romans, however, seem not to have reacted. In any case, Jesus continued teaching in the temple during the following days and had the effrontery to taunt its priests and officials, clearly referring to himself and his teaching. Have ye not read even this scripture? The stone which the builders rejected, the same was made the head of the corner? It's interesting to observe that in the quarry where he is believed to have met his end, his disciples would have cause to reflect on this saying concerning the stone which the builders rejected, both a reference to the Psalms and a precise description of the rock of Golgotha. This passage is cited in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and the Acts, which shows its importance in the context of the early Christian understanding of the arrest, trial, and execution of Jesus. Eventually, the Gospels blame his challenge to authority and his betrayal by one of his own disciples, Judas Iscariot, for Jesus' arrest. When his barbed comments and stories were directed at them, the temple authorities tried to get their hands on him, but were afraid of the reaction of the admiring crowds. The chief priests had a collaborator among the 12, Judas Iscariot, who, for 30 pieces of silver, agreed to betray Jesus when he was away from his crowds of supporters. Luke chapter 22, verse 6. On the first day of unleavened bread, Jesus ate with his disciples in a specially prepared upper room in the city, a meal they were told never to forget, as they were charged by Jesus to continue to celebrate such a meal in remembrance of him. In response to this charge, a ritual reenactment became and remains the central act of worship of all Christian communities, the Lord's Supper, Holy Communion, or Mass. The Gospels relate that after the supper they went a little way outside the walls back towards Bethany, across the Kidron, to a garden called Gethsemane, at the foot of the Mount of Olives. At the appearance of Judas, who betrayed Jesus, identifying him with a kiss, swords were out, and in the clash the high priest's servant lost his ear. But Jesus stilled the fight and went quietly to his fate. Jesus was taken first to the house of Caiaphas, the high priest, where the chief priests got him to confess that he was the Son of God, and so themselves became witnesses to this blasphemy. He was beaten and mocked. In the morning he was bound and sent to Pontius Pilate at the Antonia Fortress, or possibly the Praetorium. Today the site marked as the beginning of the Via Dolorosa is the Antonia Fortress at the northwest corner of the temple precincts, but it was just a large tower with a garrison and soldiers' quarters, not a palace. A trial was much more likely to have taken place on the Praetorium, or raised platform of the citadel next door to the palace, at the northwestern corner of the city walls, in which case the route to Golgotha, the Via Dolorosa, would have been very different and shorter. The Stations of the Cross on the way to Golgotha today are observed by many Christians as a slow and contemplative exercise, whether here in Jerusalem or at marked points in procession around their own parish church. The precise sacred geography of Jerusalem has always mattered to the pilgrim, which is true for pilgrims of all three Abrahamic religions. For Christians, the holiest sites were those identified with the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus, located by long religious tradition in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Golgotha. In the return formed by the first and second walls on the northwest of the city was a worked-out hilltop quarry with a promontory approximately 10, in places 13, metres above the floor of the workings. It had been a quarry since the Iron Age, from the 9th to 8th centuries BCE, and in use until the 1st century BCE. It's interesting to observe that the promontory literally was stone of the quarry that the builders had rejected, because there was a crack that ran down its red-veined whiteness. Today, that stone promontory is found just to the right of the Holy Sepulchre, enclosed in chapels on entering the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It had the appearance of a skull, hence Golgotha, or in its Latin derivation, Calvary. In 1988, it was archaeologically analysed when its marble covering was removed during excavations. The tradition maintains that it was on this rocky knoll that the grisly procession stopped. They offered Jesus wine mingled with myrrh or gall, probably to numb the excruciating pain of what was about to happen. They crucified him with a titulus above his head. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." The other two prisoners were crucified on either side of him. It would now take hours for them to die. Only at the ninth hour, Jesus cried aloud and died. The Gospel of Mark then says that the veil of the temple was rent, the earth shook, and the rocks split. Joseph of Arimathea, whose final tomb is said to be through the Jacobite chapel to the west of the sepulchre, then went to Pilate to ask that Jesus' body be released to him for burial. And, having determined that he was already dead, Pilate granted the request. Joseph clearly must have been a man of substance to gain direct access to Pilate himself. The biblical story recounts that when the Sabbath was over, early on the first day of the week, those who came to anoint the body found not Jesus but an angel, who declared that Jesus was risen from the dead. The Gospels differ considerably in the details of the breathlessly excited narrative, but the core of each account is that angels call his followers to witness that the tomb where they had laid him was now empty. In what may well be an interpolation, the text of the Jewish War, by contrast, gives a very cool summary of the whole sequence of events. About this time, the uprising over Herod's building of the aqueduct, there lived Jesus, a wise man, if indeed one ought to call him a man. He was the Messiah, the so-called Christ. When Pilate, upon hearing him accused by men of the highest standing amongst us, had condemned him to be crucified, those who had in the first place come to love him did not give up their affection for him. On the third day he appeared to them restored to life, for the prophets of God had prophesied these and countless other marvellous things about him. And the tribe of Christians, so called after him, has still to this day not disappeared. So it was, and so it remains. The place was seen as the existential connection with the man, Jesus, and as evidence for the confirmation of their faith. Pilgrimage and worship. To refer to pilgrimage at this early date may seem odd, but the Gospels of Mark and Matthew, which were probably written between 65 and 100 CE, only a few decades later, insistently draw attention to the physical place where they laid the body. This has the immediacy of speech, addressed directly by a narrator to a listener, perhaps even during a liturgy or public performance. Further, there is physical evidence of pilgrimage before 135, when Hadrian had a temple of Jupiter Capitolinus built on the site. A stone inscribed in Latin, "Lord, we have gone," with the drawing of a ship, was found reused as part of a foundation wall of Hadrian's temple, near the very spot recently archaeologically proposed as a place of the crucifixion. The phrase is connected with the Latin version of the Pilgrim's Psalm 121, verse 1. "Let us go into the house of the Lord." The place of discovery, the language and its peculiarities, and the subject of the drawing together link the graffito to Christians coming from the western part of the empire, probably from North Africa, Italy, Gaul, or Spain. So, by the middle of the second century, it's very likely that there was already an established pilgrim traffic coming from very considerable distances. The drawing shows what appears to be a broken mast, so this may be an early ex voto, offering thanks for deliverance on a perilous journey, like the one experienced by Josephus himself on his way to Rome, as in chapter 2. There is no suggestion of building in this area before Hadrian's temple in 135, but that doesn't preclude liturgical use of the space around the tomb, just as today. The lower fill in the quarry would have aided this use, and it dates from as early as the 1st century CE. The first Christians continued to worship in the temple after the death of Jesus, and, when not in Jerusalem, they worshipped in synagogues. Both synagogues and the first distinctively Christian places of worship were most commonly conversions of domestic buildings in insulae or mixed-use blocks, like the pair discovered in excavations at Capernaum between 1968 and 1991. Usually, the community would outgrow occasional religious use of domestic space, and physical changes would be carried out on the structure in response to the pressure of its new religious use. In Capernaum, this process can be seen at work both at the House of Peter near the lake and about 30 metres to the north at the synagogue. Beneath the podium of the magnificent classical architecture of the late 4th century prayer hall of the synagogue are the remains of private houses under the side aisles, and below its central nave is the pavement of the 1st century synagogue. Mark tells us that at the beginning of his public ministry, they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and taught. Mark chapter 1, verse 21. A few verses later, immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon, Peter, and Andrew, with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay sick with a fever, and immediately they told him of her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she served them. Mark chapter 1, verses 29 to 31. In the synagogue, there are archaeological layers of Jewish worship, and the House of Peter likewise has layers of Christian worship. The large room identified as the House of Peter in the insula stands out with a unique treatment in Capernaum. The lowest stone pavement in the courtyard had traces of a fire and late Hellenistic potsherds, both dating it and indicating its domestic use. The stone pavement, second from the bottom, was from the 1st century CE. In the room itself, there were also several layers with embedded domestic remains, including cooking pots and so on, dating from the 2nd century BCE to the late 1st century CE. Above this were half a dozen layers of white plaster that had been kept very clean. There were no daily domestic items found in these levels, only small pieces of Herodian lamps from the second half of the first century CE. This appears to have been a Christian cultic center, and services probably took place in this white room with the lamps, though questions remain. It was about 7 meters square, just adequate for worship, but the room was so sacred it wasn't itself enlarged for congregational use, unlike other similar domestic settings. It could, however, have been used within a service in the adjacent courtyards, in much the same way as a cave of the Nativity is used today, with small processions entering the room at different points during the service. About a century later than the dating of those Herodian lamps, Justin Martyr wrote the earliest surviving description of the Christian Eucharistic service, which harkens back to the supper of the Gospel narrative in that upper room before the arrest of Jesus. "We afterwards, that is, after baptism and first Eucharist, continually remind each other of these things. The wealthy among us help all those in need, and we always keep together. For everything we receive, we praise the Maker of all things through his Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. On the so-called Sunday, everyone in town or countryside gathers together in one place, and the memoirs of the apostles or the writings of the prophets are read out for as long as time permits. Next, when the reader has finished, the president in an address admonishes and exhorts us to imitate these good examples. Then we all stand up together and offer prayers. When we have finished praying, as I said before, bread, wine, and water are brought out, and the president offers prayers of thanks to the best of his ability. The people assent, saying Amen, and each person receives and shares in that over which thanks have been given, and a portion is taken by the deacons to those not present. The wealthy and the willing each gives what he wants, as each sees fit, and what is collected is deposited with the president. He helps orphans and widows and those in need through sickness or any other reason, those in prison, foreigners staying with us. In a word, he takes care of everyone in distress. On Sunday, we make our common gathering, since it is the day on which God changed darkness and matter and made the world, and on which Jesus Christ our Saviour rose from the dead." This celebration was clearly very closely associated with Jesus' resurrection, so it would be interesting to know what that meant for the associated site, the Holy Sepulchre. The house of St. Peter is only yards from the shore of Lake Galilee, so it would have been ideal as a place for baptism. A somewhat different form of worship celebrated in such places was also described by Tertullian, an early Christian apologist, at the end of the second century. "We meet together as an assembly and congregation, that offering up prayer to God as with united force we may wrestle with him in our supplications. We assemble to read our sacred writings, if any peculiarity of the times makes either forewarning or reminiscence needful. Our feast explains itself by its name. The Greeks call it agape, that is, affection. The participants, before reclining, taste first of prayer to God. As much is eaten as satisfies the cravings of hunger, as much is drunk as benefits the chaste. After manual ablution and the bringing in of lights, each is asked to stand forth and sing, as he can, a hymn to God, either one from the Holy Scriptures or one of his own composing, a proof of the measure of our drinking. As the feast commenced with prayer, so with prayer it is closed." It sounds very informal, and the readings, songs, and prayers would clearly vary from service to service and from place to place, depending on what forewarning or reminiscence was needed. The picture he paints is consistent with the detail from the Gospels, Acts, and Epistles. And interestingly, he mentions the lights being brought in, consistent with the Herodian lamps in the white plaster layer at the house of Peter. There, the walls were plastered too, and the summary archaeological report notes that they were covered with geometric designs and graffiti that were clearly Christian and dating from the early 3rd to the early 5th centuries. The graffiti referred in various ways in different languages to Jesus, Peter, and the liturgy. So in the 3rd century, there were probably both a local congregation and also pilgrims. One of those pilgrims in the early 380s was Egeria, who was a pilgrim to Jerusalem. She was a woman, perhaps from Gaul or Spain, who kept a remarkable journal in which she recorded that in Capernaum, the house of the Prince of the Apostles, Peter, has been made into a church with its original walls still standing. It's where the Lord healed the paralytic. There also is the synagogue where the Lord cured a man possessed by the devil. Such a house being converted into a church was a common pattern at this period, and the Byzantines clearly believed that this was the house of Peter, since in the second half of the 5th century, the church was transformed into an octagonal martyrium. The archaeological and literary evidence combined make the attribution as the house of Peter, at least of Egeria's pilgrimage, quite strong, despite lingering doubts. If the house of Peter had been converted to a domus ecclesia and was the focus of liturgical celebration, possibly within a generation of the death of the Prince of the Apostles, then it would have been very strange if the tomb of Christ himself had not enjoyed the same focus, though there is no suggestion of architectural activity near the sepulchre. In any event, the identity of the place depended on the tradition of the community for almost 2 centuries, while it was buried under Hadrian's Temple of Jupiter, from 135 to its recovery under Constantine in 326. The height of the traditional rock of Calvary is so much higher than the rest that it may have protruded from the temenos, or walled platform of Hadrian's Temple, and been topped by a statue of Venus, a particular abomination for Christians. This may have been a clear, if offensive, marker for the site. The destruction of Jerusalem and the memory of the Christian community. Without a strong succession after the death of Herod Agrippa, a political chaos and exploitation ensued, inflaming resentment against Rome. There were other charismatic leaders of insurrections, including the Egyptian who recently stirred up a revolt and led the 4,000 men of the assassins out into the wilderness, Acts chapter 21, verse 38, whom the tribune thought Paul might be when he was arrested. All Jerusalem was in confusion, and a riot had started when Paul was accused of taking a Gentile, or non-Jew, into the temple. Paul had been enormously successful in expanding Christianity, or the Way, among the Gentiles, though he himself had been a deeply committed Jew who persecuted the church before his own conversion. The core of the Christianity he preached was Christ crucified for the sin of the world and resurrected for its salvation. So it wouldn't be surprising to find that early pilgrims to the Holy Sepulchre and Calvary were converts from that Gentile mission, come to see for themselves the place of witness. Paul didn't escape custody. As a Roman citizen, he insisted on putting his case before Caesar in Rome, where he would encounter Peter before they were both put to death there in 64 to 65 CE. Their shrines in Rome, especially Peter's on the Vatican Hill, would have immense importance for the history of the church and the papacy, as in chapter 2. The years from 66 to 70 CE saw the Jewish War, which was later chronicled by Josephus, who was himself a Jewish general for the early part of the war and later became so Roman as to take the emperor's name, Flavius Josephus. His writings clearly had a very particular bias. That notwithstanding, the course of the war and its devastating conclusion had more to do with politics in Rome than the threat in Judea. Christians began to leave the doomed city in 67, according to Eusebius, bishop of Caesarea and Christian historian under Constantine, in his History of the Church from Christ to Constantine. Nero had sent his general, Titus Flavius Vespasianus, to deal with the rebellion. It was eventually Vespasian's son, Titus, who crushed Jerusalem and destroyed the temple, as Jesus had prophesied according to the Gospels. Josephus says, Caesar ordered the whole city and the temple to be razed to the ground. All the rest of the wall encompassing the city, except around the citadel, was so completely leveled to the ground as to leave future visitors to the spot no ground for believing that it had ever been inhabited. The booty from the city and the temple treasure were taken to Rome in triumph, as recorded on the Arch of Titus. The temple treasure was housed in the Temple of Peace, but the veil of the temple went to the imperial palace. The spoils paid for the building of the Colosseum, where many Christians faced martyrdom. Jerusalem was a ruin, and the temple would never be rebuilt. Jerusalem remained a desolate ruin. Temple worship ceased, definitively, and the synagogue became the focus of Jewish piety. Christians had been a sect of Judaism, but now had every reason to separate themselves, and they continued to worship in Jerusalem. When Aelius Hadrianus visited in 130 CE, the city was still a ruin, except for a few houses and the little Church of God. That was the upper room where the disciples entered when they returned from the Mount of Olives after the ascension of the Redeemer. It was built there, namely on Sion. There was another Jewish rebellion under Simon bar Kochba, who dealt harshly with the Christians who wouldn't accept that he was the Messiah. Quoting the philosopher Justin Martyr, Eusebius says that they were sentenced to terrible punishments if they did not deny Jesus Christ and blaspheme him. Hadrian, in turn, was pitiless in his devastation of the land and its people. This is an illustration of the interpretation of Jerusalem that contemporary Christians would have heard from the pulpit, and they would have circulated among pilgrims. The revolt had been crushed in 135, and Jews were then forbidden even to approach Elia. Looking back over two centuries, Eusebius wrote with polemical zeal, "From that time on, the entire race has been forbidden to set foot anywhere in the neighborhood of Jerusalem under the terms and ordinances of a law of Hadrian." When in this way the city was closed to the Jewish race and suffered the total destruction of its former inhabitants, it was colonized by an alien race, and the Roman city which subsequently arose changed its name, so that now, in honor of the emperor then reigning, Aelius Hadrianus, it is known as Aelia. Furthermore, as the church in the city was now composed of Gentiles, the first after the bishops of the circumcision to be put in charge of the Christians there was Mark. Having renamed Judea Palestina, Hadrian laid out a new Roman city to be named for Rome and his own family, Aelia Capitolina. The ghost of its shape is still visible. Excavations at the Damascus Gate now reveal more clearly his Neapolis gate, at the end of today's Nablus Road, where he reused huge Herodian stones. Inside the gate was an oval forum with a column at its centre, as seen in the 6th century mosaic Mardabar map. The two main rows forked from there, one running southwest, today's El Wad, towards the Antonia fortress, the other the Cardo, due south, today's Souq Khan Ez-Zeyt, to the Temple of Capitoline Jupiter built on the old quarry and the site of what would become the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. The quarry had to be completely filled, burying the sepulchre, but the rock of Golgotha itself may have protruded above the temenos, or sacred precinct of the temple. A small section of the southeastern temenos wall can still be seen. Nor did interest in the holy sites abate after this architectural assault. During the reign of Antoninus, when Bishop Narcissus of Elea was very old and too incapacitated to carry out his duties, Alexander, bishop in Cappadocia, travelled to Jerusalem in order to worship there and to examine the historic sites. Providentially, as a result of coming on pilgrimage to Jerusalem, he became its bishop and exercised authority there until his death in the persecution under the Emperor Decius between 249 and 251. The contemporary Christian scholar and theologian Origen, circa 185 to circa 254, went to Palestina from Alexandria in 215. Origen settled in Caesarea in 231 and founded a school. It's in his writings, of which much is now lost, that ancient associations of the temple are seen to migrate to Golgotha. Christians made these stories their own, in the same way as they had made Jewish prophecies and scriptures their own. Origen interpreted scripture on three levels, literal, moral, and allegorical, with a strong emphasis on the last. It's in his writings, later repeated in 388 by St. Jerome, who had come to Jerusalem in about 385, that the grave of Adam is situated at the foot of Golgotha. With beautiful theological symmetry, Origen made the blood of Jesus, the second Adam, flow down over sinful Adam's bones. Like Bishop Alexander, Origen too perished as a result of his injuries sustained during the Decian persecution. Constantine and Christian unity. The politics of empire played out on a battlefield on the outskirts of Rome was to have an almost unimaginable impact on the history of the church. A reported vision of the cross, the instrument of Jesus's brutal execution, would eventually lead to the unearthing of the witness to his resurrection. In 312 CE, following Constantine's vision of the cross in a blaze of light over the sun, with the command, "By this conquer," at the Milvian Bridge outside Rome, he went on to victory over the usurper Maxentius. An earlier account says that it was revealed to him in a dream to put the sign of God on the soldiers' shields and then engage in battle. He did as he was commanded, and by means of a slanted letter X with the top of its head bent round, he marked Christ on their shields. This was made up of the first two Greek letters, chi and rho. He attributed his victory to the risen Christ and converted to the new religion and immediately began building the Lateran Basilica, soon to be followed by St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. His mother, the Dowager Empress Helena, may already have been a Christian by this time, but in any case, she came to play an influential part in the practical effects in Jerusalem, at the very least, of Constantine's conversion to Christianity. Whether he was converted as a religious visionary or as an astute politician on a mission to reunify the empire, the practical effects are indisputable. Licinius, ruler of the Balkans, made a marriage alliance with Constantine and soon defeated Maximinus, emperor in Asia Minor, who had failed to abide by the agreement in the Edict of Milan to stop the persecution of Christians and return their confiscated property. In the coming years, Licinius too returned to persecution and suffered defeats by Constantine in 316, and finally in 324, Constantine was in full control of both East and West. Jerusalem and the holy places were now under his sole authority. There was a simmering dispute within the church over the date of the celebration of Easter. Then, a more serious division arose over the nature of Christ, human or divine, and this threatened to split the church. With churchmen coming to blows and very worryingly insulting the image of the emperor, Constantine wrote to the disputants, Arius and Alexander. My first concern was that the attitude towards the divinity of all the provinces should be united in a consistent view, and my second, that I might restore and heal the body of the Republic which lay severely wounded. The unity of the Church was clearly seen as essential to the unity of the Empire. Constantine warned the disputants to set their disagreements aside, but they persisted. In 325, all the bishops, including Bishop Macarius of Jerusalem, a suffragan or subordinate bishop, and Bishop Eusebius of Caesarea, his metropolitan, were summoned to a general council at Nicaea to resolve the argument. Christians had been united during their persecution and fiercely loyal to their Lord and one another. They were resourceful and well organized. So it was politically important for Constantine that the church be a unifying force for the empire, which, in its vastness and diversity, was constantly threatening to fragment. He couldn't afford for his new religion to do the same. More than 250 bishops assembled from the whole world, from Spain to Persia, and the emperor himself entered the council dressed in purple and gold. Eusebius tells us that Constantine addressed them gently, as friends, and pressed them irresistibly towards unanimity. The council ended in the imperial palace to celebrate the 20th year of the emperor's reign with a banquet that might have been supposed was an imaginary representation of the kingdom of Christ. Building unity. Constantine was determined to reverse the fortunes of the church and wrote to Eusebius, "Where therefore you yourself are in charge of churches or know other bishops and presbyters or deacons to be locally in charge of them, remind them to attend to the church buildings, whether by restoring or enlarging the existing ones, or where necessary, building new."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.